This conference will now be recorded.
Intratemporal part, it is the bony part as well as previous. In the intratemporal part, it has got the meatal part in which it travels along with the eighth cranial nerve, that is the vestibular popliteal nerve, that is about 8 to 10 mm and within the internal acoustic meatus. And the labyrinthine part, which is about 4 mm in length. And it is from the fundus to the first genu, that is denticular ganglia, and it is the narrowest and the shortest segment. That narrowest means 0.61 to 0.68 mm in width. And so any edema in this area, example in the case of herpes zoster or in the case of edematous facial nerve palsy, it can lead to the compression of this part of the cranial, seventh cranial nerve. And third one is the tympanic or the horizontal part, which is about 11 mm. You can visualize this part directly in the middle ear after lifting the tympanic membrane forwards. Length is about 11 mm and it is from the genicular ganglion, that is first genu, to the pyramidal membrane, that is the second genu. Genu is nothing but the bend of the facial nerve and lies above the oval window. Fourth one is mastoid at the vertical part of the intratemporal part, that is about 13 mm. It is from the pyramid to the stylomastoid foramen. Pyramid means the second genu to the stylomastoid foramen, which is the exit point of the facial nerve from the skull. Extracranial part, it is the stylomastoid foramen to the termination of the branches. That is, you know about the pes anserinus, that is the terminal branches of the facial nerve. Up to that part is the extracranial part. Branches of the facial nerve, first one is the greater superficial petrosal nerve, GSPN, from the geniculate ganglion and carries secretomotor fibers to the lacrimal gland and also the glands of the nasal mucosa and the palate. It is the secretomotor function. And second one is the nerve to stapedius. It is a motor nerve which controls the intensity of the sound. And third one is the cauda tympani, which carries the secretomotor fibers to the submandibular and sublingual glands and also taste to the anterior two-thirds of the tongue. Fourth one is the communicating branches. Along with the vagus nerve, it supplies the concha and also the retroauricular groove and the posterior meatus, that is nothing but the posterior wall of the external artery canal and the outer surface of the tympanic membrane. Fifth one is the posterior auricular nerve to the muscles of the pinna. It is the extracranial part and also the occipito frontalis occipital belly and communicates with the auricular branch of the vagus nerve. As I said previously, another one is the muscular branches. These are the stylohyoid and posterior belly of the digastric, and the peripheral branches come from the extracranial part in the parotid gland area, which are called as the pes anserinus. It has got two divisions, temporofacial and also cervicofacial. These are further divided into temporal, buccal, and cervical and also the mandibular branches and also the frontal branch. It is the course of the facial nerve. As I said, it takes internal genu within the brainstem. It is nothing but it circles around the sixth cranial nerve and comes out and joins with the sensory fibers, which is known as the nerve of Risberg, and it travels in the internal acoustic meatus. It is the meatal foramen. And it is the internal acoustic meatus starting area, and it is the fundus of the internal acoustic meatus. From fundus and into the geniculate ganglion, it is the labyrinthine part, and from there it takes the temporal tympanic part of the facial nerve, and then it takes the second genu. It is the second genu of the facial nerve. From here the stapedius muscle arises, and here the cauda tympani nerve arises, and then continues to come outside through the cranial cavity through the stylomastoid foramen. It is a parotid gland. These are the terminal branches of the facial nerve extracranially. These are mostly motor terminal branches. Blood supply of the facial nerve. It is nothing but the plexus of the blood vessels within the facial nerve. It has got the external plexus and also the intraneural plexus. Extraneural plexus form a network of vessels around the facial nerve, which has got the minor branches which supply the intraneural plexus within the facial nerve. First one is the ICA or the anteroinferior cerebellar artery, which is a branch of the basilar artery. it is in the CP angle part of the facial nerve. And the labyrinthine part, it is a branch of the IGA, which is nothing but the anteroinferior cerebellar artery. It supplies the internal acoustic meatus part, that is within the meatus. Third one is the superficial petrosal part of the artery. It is a branch of the middle meningeal artery, which is middle meningeal artery is nothing but the branch of the maxillary artery, internal maxillary artery. It supplies from the geniculate ganglia on the adjacent part. And stylomastoid artery, it is a branch of the posterior auricular artery. And also in some patients, the stylomastoid artery comes out from the occipital artery, posterior auricular artery and the occipital artery. These are the branches of the external carotid, and they supply the mastoid in the tympanic part of the facial nerve. All the arteries form an external plexus, as I said previously, in the pineurium, and feed the deep intraneural internal plexus. It is a picture depicting the blood supply to the facial nerve. This is the ICA, which is a branch of the basilar artery, and it provides a branch to the internal acoustic meatus. And second one is the labyrinthine artery, and third one is the petrosal artery, which is superficial petrosal artery from the middle meningeal artery. See, you can see it is a branch of the internal maxillary artery, which is a branch of external carotid artery. And third one is the stylomastoid artery, which is a branch of posterior auricular artery. In some patients, it can arise from the occipital artery. These are all the branches of the external carotid artery. Surgical landmarks. Before going to the surgery, every surgeon should know about the surgical landmarks to easily identify the facial nerve with intraoperatively. For middle ear and mastoid surgery, it is nothing but the process of cochlear formis, which is the prominence over the medial wall of the middle ear. I will show you in the picture afterwards. And second one is the verbal window and the horizontal semicircular canal. It is a crucial part where, while doing the cortical mastoidectomy, after identification of the horizontal semicircular canal, you stop the surgery there, because further drilling can lead to the damage to the facial nerve. That is second zone of the facial nerve. Third one is the incus short process. It is the landmark where when you identify the incus short process, you shouldn't go below the incus short process level, because it can lead to the damage to the vertical part of the facial nerve. Fourth one is the pyramid. Pyramid is nothing but the stapedius, the place where stapedius tendon arises. It is a it depicts deeper to this pyramid is the facial nerve, vertical part of the facial nerve. Fifth one is the tympanomastoid suture. The facial nerve lies about 6 to 8 mm medial to the tympanomastoid suture. So whenever you identify the tympanomastoid suture, you have to be careful while drilling there. And last one is the digastric ridge. Between the digastric ridge and the styloid process in the skull face area or below the skull, the facial nerve comes out of the extracranial or the temporal bone. And in the case of parotid surgery, which is the extracranial part, these are the landmarks. First one is the cartilaginous straggle pointer. It is nothing but a triangular piece of cartilage. You can identify by keeping a finger over there. Internal nerve lies 1 cm deep and anterior to it. It is nothing but the straggle cartilage only. Deeper the starting point of straggle cartilage, you have to identify clearly, and there will be a pointer, like in the case of conical pointer, deep to that is the facial nerve. Second one is the tympanomastoid suture. Nerve lies 6 to 8 mm deep to this, as I said previously. And third one is the styloid process. Nerve process lateral to this. I said previously, the nerve comes out of the temporal bone between the styloid and the posterior belly of the digastric. Fourth one is the posterior belly of digastric and the attachment to the digastric groove. Nerve lies between this and the styloid process. It is the picture depicting the surgical landmarks. It is the lateral semicircular canal. It is the medial wall of the middle ear. And it is the lateral semicircular canal. It is the horizontal part of the facial nerve. Here it will be the first genu. Here it will be the second genu. And it is the oval window. And it is the pyramid from which the stapedius tendon arises. It is the vertical part of the facial nerve. It is the tympanic process of the promontory. This is the process of cochlear formis. And it is one of the landmark. Oval window is also a landmark. Lateral semicircular canal, pyramidal process. And in the case of parotid surgery, you can see it is the tragus, and deep to this, when you dissect deeply, you can identify the cartilaginous pointer there. 1 centimeter deep and anterior to it is the facial nerve, and in the styloid process, lateral to the styloid process, the facial nerve, and in the digastric muscle, posterior is the sternocleidomastoid, and in the posterior biliary digastric, between the digastric and the styloid process is the cranial cavum, which exits from the temporal bone. Variations and anomalies of the facial nerve. First one is the bony dehiscence, which it is the most common anomaly. Bony dehiscence of the facial nerve, it is most commonly seen in the horizontal part of the facial nerve. It is the horizontal or the tympanic part of the facial nerve. In the picture you can see below the lateral subcircular canal, between the first genu and the second genu. And the dehiscence is seen most commonly in about 55% of the patients, 50 to 55% of the patients, in the normal individuals only, not the patients. And the second one is the prolapse of the nerve. The prolapse of the nerve occurs because of the bony dehiscence mostly, and the prolapse occurs most commonly over the bowel window. So in the case of stepidotomy or stepidectomy, while removing the stapes suprastructure, it will be a difficult procedure if there is a overhang of the facial nerve over to the bowel window. Third one is the hump near the lateral subcircular canal. It can get injured during the mastoid surgery, because it is lateral subcircular canal is one of the landmark while doing the cortical mastoidectomy. And when you drill the deeply without recognizing the lateral subcircular canal, you can damage the second genu and the vertical part of the facial. Fourth one is the bifurcation and trifurcation of the facial nerve. And fifth one is the bifurcation and enclosing the stapes. And sixth one is the between the oval and round windows. It takes two branches, which go on meet at the second genu. And these anomalies are more common in the congenital ear malformation. So care should be taken while operating the microtias, that is micro ear, that is a congenital malformation, and another congenital malformation. It is a picture showing facial nerve anomalies. It is the ischemiobarifis, and is the stapedius tendon, and is stapes superstructure. It is the prolapse of the facial nerve in the second picture B, and in the C you get bony dehiscence and also the prolapse of the facial nerve in the B and C. In the D, it is below the stapes, that is below the bowel window. In the E, it is covering the bowel window. In the F, you can see directly it is coming out of the normal course of the facial nerve, that is tympanic and the vertical part, and joining at the stylomastoid foramen through the promoter. These are the other anomalies. That is normal course of the facial nerve. It is the first genu, and it is the second genu below the lateral subcircular canal or the horizontal subcircular canal. Normally, the nerve passes between the lateral subcircular canal and the bowel window as the tympanic part of the facial nerve. And B is the bony dehiscence of the facial nerve, which can lead to the prolapse of the facial nerve. Third one, EC, is the hump of the facial nerve over the lateral subcircular canal. And D is the, you can see bifurcation in the vertical part of the facial nerve. It bifurcates into two branches. C is the trifurcation. It divides into three branches in the vertical part of the facial nerve. In the F, it is the two branches are given anterior to the bowel window, and these two branches travel above and below to the bowel window and meet at the second genu, and they continue as the vertical part of the facial nerve. And G is the complete facial nerve course goes below the bowel window, that is between the bowel and the round windows, and then continues into the vertical part of the facial nerve. Structure of any nerve is defined by, it is covered by endoneurium, perineurium, and epineurium. Endoneurium is nothing but it is the covering of the single axon fiber, its single nerve fiber, that is axon. And perineurium, it is a collection of the nerve fibers, which are called as fascicles. And epineurium, it is a collection of the fascicles, that is it covers completely the complete nerve. Nerve injury, CBRT is defined by classified by Seddon's and the Sunderland's classification. Seddon's classification, you know about this, about the neuropraxia, axonotomesis, and neurotomesis. And the second one is the Sunderland classification. It has got 5 degrees of nerve injury. First degree is the partial blockage to the flow of axoplasm. There will be only partial block to the axoplasm. Whenever the pressure relieves, the axoplasmic flow continues. Second degree is the loss of the axon with the intact endoneural tube. That is, the axon is totally cut off, but the endoneurium is kept intact. And so the nerve can regenerate freely. After that, there will be no syngenesis. That is, syngenesis is nothing but formation of nerve fibers from one nerve fiber to another nerve fiber. It will not be seen here because of the intact endoneural tubes. Third degree is the injury to the endoneurium. That is, the nerve fibers can communicate easily with each other, and so it can lead to syngenesis. That is, one fiber can grow and attach to the distal part of the other fiber, so it can lead to syngenesis. And fourth degree is the injury to the perineurium. It is nothing but partial transection of the facial nerve, and there can be syngenesis here, and also there will be remnants of the paralysis. In the fifth degree, there will be injury to the epineurium also, that is complete transection. In here, we can suture the nerve ends directly, or we can go for a nerve graft between them, because whenever the nerve is cut, it can lead to the retraction of the proximal and distal ends of the nerve. And so, to counter the pressure, we can keep a nerve graft. Example, the nerves most commonly used nerves are the sural nerve and the greater auricular nerve. First 3 degrees seen in the viral and inflammatory disorders. You can see here, first, second, and third degrees are seen in viral and inflammatory disorders, because there is a simple, it is that these disorders are nothing but a complete edema of the nerve fibers, and so there will be only compression of the axons. While fourth and fifth degrees are seen in surgical or accidental trauma or in neoplasms. There is a certain test to detect the facial paralysis. One is the topo diagnostic test, and second one is the electro diagnostic test. Topo diagnostic test, I have not mentioned here. These are nothing but the Schirmer's test to look for the amount of the lacrimal flow, that is amount of TF produced. By keeping a paper into the lower fornix of the eyelid, you can measure the amount of the TF fluid. And second one is the electrogastrometry or the taste sensation. Third one is the salivary flow measurement in the parotid gland by keeping a tube into the bilateral water slit. And electrodiagnostic test, these involve the minimal nerve excitability test. Nerve stimulated with the steady increase in intensity till facial twitch appears and compared with the normal side of the face. And in conductive blocks, there will be no difference between the normal and the paralyzed side. And in other injuries, there will be degeneration in the distal part of the facial nerve, and nerve excitability is lost here. When difference between the two sides is more than 3.5 milliamps, it is positive for degeneration, and degeneration cannot be detected earlier than the 48 to 72 hours of its convolution. Second test is the maximal stimulation test. It is similar to the minimal nerve excitability test, but current level, which gives maximal facial movement when the facial nerve is stimulated, it is determined and compared to the normal side, and reduced or absent response to the maximal stimulation indicates degeneration. Degeneration is nothing but the complete degeneration of the facial nerve. You can see when the facial nerve is injured, the proximal part can get degeneration up to the first node of Ranvier, whereas the distal part undergoes Wellerian degeneration. That is complete degeneration of the distal part. Electroneuronography, it is nothing but evoked electromyography compared with the normal side, and percentage of degenerating fibers is calculated by this electroneuronography. Degeneration of 90% of the fibers in first 14 days indicates poor recovery of the function. And most useful between the 4th and 21st day of the onset of the complete paralysis. After the 21st day, you can go for the electromyography directly. EMG test the EMG is nothing but the electromyography. It tests the motor activity of the facial nerves. Recordings are made during the rest and voluntary contraction. That is during the rest period without any movement of the face, facial muscles, and during the voluntary contraction by the patient itself. In a normal resting muscle, biphasic or triphasic potentials are seen every 30 to 50 milliseconds. Whereas in a denervated muscle, spontaneous involuntary action potentials are seen. These are called as fibrillation potentials between 14 and 21 days. These are also similar to the lower cranial nerve palsy, lower motor neuron palsy you have studied in the medicine, general medicine. And second one are the polyphasic potentials. These are seen in the nerve fibers, which are regenerating after the injury. These polyphasic potentials appear 6 to 12 weeks prior to the clinical evidence of the facial function return. And so they are the earliest evidence of the recovery. Once again, I will tell, this is a fibrillation potential, is nothing but the involuntary action potentials. These are mostly seen in the denervated muscle, that is degenerating muscle. And polyphasic potentials, these are mostly seen in the regenerating nerve fibers after the injury. These polyphasic potentials are the earliest evidence of the recovery. These are useful in planning the readmission process. Readmission procedures are nothing but taking the muscle from one part of the body and transferring it onto the face. Example, the gracilis muscle and also the masseter muscle. We can use them as the reanimating procedures muscles. These muscles are transferred and the nerve fibers are anastomosed with the fifth cranial nerve, that is trigeminal nerve or the massetric nerve. Presence of polyphasic potentials indicate no need of reanimation, because as I said previously, polyphasic potentials are nothing but they are the earliest evidence of the recovery. These are mostly seen about 6 to 12 weeks prior to the clinical evidence of the facial function return. Fibrillation potentials indicate intact motor endplate and need for nerve stimulation. That is, whenever you come across the fibrillation potentials, it indicates about the intact motor endplate. These are motor endplates which are present over the muscle. And in these patients, you can go for reanimation because there are intact motor endplates. And third signals are the electrical silence, which indicates atrophy of the motor endplates and need for muscle transfer procedures rather than nerve stimulation. Electroneuronography and electromyography are complementary and help to prognosticate in cases of facial paralysis and deciding the facial reanimation process. That is nothing but electroneuronography. It is mostly useful up to the 14th day or the 21st day, whereas EMG, it is useful after the 14th day or the 21st day. Electroneuronography tells about the amount of the nerve fibers degenerated, whereas EMG tells about the persistence of the nerve fibers and also the motor endplate, where we can go for the reanimation procedures or simple nerve grafting can be done. How to decide by these two tests. Thank you.